has assured the United Nations that harsh actions will be taken against those who commit sexual violence. Laval comes as a UN Security Council envoy continues its mission in Bangladesh and Myanmar to see the aftermath of the military crackdown in Rakhine State. Nearly 700,000 Rohingya Muslims have fled the area amid reports of violent attacks in their villages. On Monday, the UN team met with Myanmar's de facto leader, Aung San Suu Kyi. Until now, the country's government has rejected UN requests to visit the region. Knut Ostby is the UN resident and humanitarian coordinator in Myanmar. He joins me now from Naypyidaw via Skype. And sir, thank you so much for joining us here in the program. A lot of questions to ask you. First, your meeting with Aung San Suu Kyi, the UN Security Council delegation met with her. The group pressed her for access into Myanmar. Was she receptive to that message?
Thank you very much. It was a very useful exchange of views. I'm very happy that we have from the government, including from Aung San Suu Kyi, as an interest now in negotiating the UN, UNHCR and UNDP in particular, in organizing the return of refugees and preparing the conditions for refugees. And I'm very glad we also have the Security Council support for that.
Important and in that meeting with Aung San Suu Kyi, did you get the sense that Aung San Suu Kyi is acknowledging that, yes, this is a crisis? Or is she still in denial of the crackdown, of what caused nearly 700,000 Rohingya Muslims to flee her country?
This crisis, as you said, has caused more than 700,000 people to leave. I think Aung San Suu Kyi needs to speak for herself. But we are very glad they are willing to negotiate the return of refugees in a condition, voluntary and dignified manner. There's still some negotiations left before we can conclude an agreement, but I'm very optimistic that we can reach a situation where there can be the return of refugees in the right conditions.
Okay, got it. You also managed to get access to Rakhine State. That's the area from which the Rohingya fled. When the group traveled and was able to assess Rakhine, did you manage to get an accurate assessment of what happened?
We flew over with a helicopter. We visited several villages and we visited areas the government is preparing for returns. The overflight with helicopter is a quite dramatic sight. The landscape is quite empty, it's quite opposed to the Cox Bazar area on the Bangladesh side, which is extremely crowded with refugees. The landscape is full of sites where villages have been burnt and later on bulldozed. The conditions, of course, are not quite ready for return yet. There is work to make some physical conditions ready, but it's important also that the refugees who come back have an identity. They have their rights aligned with other people living in their area, and that they have safety and they can live in peace with their neighbors.
As you say, the conditions are not quite right for the Rohingya Muslims to return to Myanmar. So in the meantime, they are toiling in these camps, these crowded camps in Bangladesh. We've seen video of members of the UN Security Council team meeting up with the refugees, confronted with some raw emotion, just young refugee women and girls crying, seeking solace. What was that like to witness? Will you be able to make their situation any better?
The refugees in Bangladesh are in a really dire condition, and the monsoon coming up in a few weeks might become a disaster within the disaster. They have very few options on where to go. And as I said, the conditions for return are not yet in place. But I think what we need to do is to focus on how the conditions can be made ready so people can return. I think this is, in spite of the difficulties, probably their best option.